Stage, Rachel Winter and William H. Macy. So I'd like to start with Rachel. It's been quite a journey with this film, and you got started on it quite some time ago. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. Am I allowed to move this chair so I can see? I can take direction. I was trying to produce this, my chair. So I read this script 100 years ago. Will Aldous is the writer. And I knew immediately that it was going to be a long haul because it was so singular and such a unique voice. But I just said, okay, well, if I'm going to spend my time trying to make movies, I'm going to spend my time on something I really believed in. And when I read something that's better, you know, that's a good reason to move off. And of course, projects come and go, but this one stuck with me. And then I had sent it to Bill's agent to act, and I got the most amazing call. Bill would like to throw his hat into the ring to direct. And I was like, I was saying earlier that it was a good thing that, you know, this was just a phone call and I wasn't in person, because I kind of was doing a jig, and I was like, okay, he has the job. And from our first phone call in 2004 or 2005, and then we went on the journey together, and he, I got him to drink the Kool-Aid, and that was it. And we got to the altar many, many times. This movie fell apart, fell together, fell apart, fell together. And, but it's all about timing, and we never gave up. And it ended up being just the right time with the right cast, and we're really proud of it. And it was so wonderful hearing everybody respond. I was a thrill.
So why did you decide to direct? What was it? What's the reason?
This film in particular, because, by the way, you are a great audience. Can we keep them? It's another screening. Thank you, Odis. I think it's a natural thing that at a point an actor wants to try his hand at directing, or her hand. And I read this and I saw it so clearly in my mind's eye. When I read a script, I try to read it in one sitting, and I skip the stage directions because they're mostly nonsense anyway. And you just go to the dialogue, and you can see the film in your mind's eye in about the same time that you'll see it in the theater. And it was so crystal clear to me, no pun intended. And I love the act, all the characters were so well drawn. I loved his dialogue. So I thought, it's a good thing there wasn't a Skype, because I was dancing at Jake too. I hung up and said, she said yes, what's wrong with this broad?
So it must have gone through several cast iterations over the 13 plus years that it was in the making. And how did that evolve? How did the project change, or how did the script change, or your vision of it from when it started?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. Mostly this stuff is driven by financing. And so when we say, you know, fall apart, fall together, you know, we can all pretend now, you know, actor schedules. It usually has to do with the money when it's in this lower budget independent realm. And so we really had, I think because the script is so original, people would be drawn in, and obviously Bill is a massive draw. I would say the number one tip in getting your, you know, people to come to your project is, you know, get Bill Macy to be a part of it, because actors are like, you know, they want to be near him, they want to work with him and for him and do their best work with him. And so we never had trouble getting actors. We had an amazing casting director, Mary Verneuil, who stuck with us the entire run. And so that was never an issue, but it did. It went through different iterations, and you know, and I think the diversity of the cast is so, that was Will's original vision. He's from the South, and it was really important to him, and aren't we glad that we didn't fuck that up.
So speaking of the outpour, what do you really think about it?
What do we think about the word fuck? It's one of the more versatile words in the English language. It could be a noun, an adjective, a verb, an adverb. What's a gerund?
And doesn't somebody we know hold a record for that?
Oh yeah, I'm very proud in my family. So my husband holds the record for the most uses of the F word in a film for writing The Wolf of Wall Street.
So directing, you know, we know you as an actor, William H. Macy, and way over 100 roles and just such memorable characters. You've worked with some of the greatest directors, from David Mamet to the Coen brothers. What did you take from them as you approached directing, and what did you do differently?
I think the biggest influences on me were Stephen Schachter, whom I wrote with for years, he was my writing partner, and probably Dave Mamet. And I think David taught me everything I know about story structure. I also took that Robert McKee course. Did anybody ever take that course? It's really quite genius. And but it's all about the prep. And I learned that from Stephen Schachter. It's all in the prep. Once the shooting begins, it's a whirlwind. All you can do is hold on. The analogy I like to use is that, especially in an indie film, you have about 6 or 7 weeks to build this magnificent structure, which is the story and your film and all the prep. And on the first day of shooting, the structure catches fire. And for about the next 5 weeks, you see the director and the producers running into the third floor, throwing shit out the window, trying to save it.
I mean, Dallas Buyers Club. Who saw Dallas Buyers Club? So you're pretty remarkable with what you've accomplished. But how did you get started?
Softcore porn.
She's not kidding.
I'm not kidding. You know, not in front of the camera, you know, God bless. But I didn't know anybody in the business, and I got an internship. The only person I knew, as it turned out, did softcore porn, who we knew through the North Valley Jewish Community Center. And actually, my best friend in the world, Julie Neal, where are you? So Julie and I, together, when we were like 5 and 6 years old, we spent time at the North Valley Jewish Community Center. It had nothing to do with softcore porn, but she can vouch for this story. So anyway, I was going to graduate college. I didn't exactly know what I was going to do, and I got an internship from this guy, and there are scripts, as it turns out, and for every 30 minutes of programming, there's 2 teases and a sex scene, and you know, you gotta know this stuff. So anyway, I did coverage on the scripts, and but that was my film boot camp, was, you know, wrangling cable, and you know, it was an experience, let me tell you. But that was an introduction, certainly, to film itself. The cameras were rolling, but it was also meeting people in the business, and it's a traveling band of gypsies who will take you in and take you along, and that certainly it wasn't necessarily the storytelling, but the community and the energy and the excitement of it. It is not glamorous, it's the opposite, but it, you realize you're really a part of something, and I don't know, you just kind of get swept along, and I just kind of fell in love with that. You know, obviously I moved up from there, and you know, it wasn't exactly softcore born to Dallas Buyers Club. It was a really long road, and then yeah, Dallas Buyers Club was obviously one of the great honors of, you know, certainly my career to have been a part of that movie. You know, one of my best friends made the film with me, Robbie Brenner, an incredible female producer. But then, you know, the best thing about the independent film is that it's the best thing and the worst thing. It takes so long to get a movie made. But I always say that if this movie had been made in a normal, you know, timetable instead of 14 years, I wouldn't have two of my best friends, which are Bill and Felicity. So, you know, it's part of being a community.
Don't you love the concept? Don't you love the concept of coverage in a porn film?
So, speaking about Felicity, how was she to work with on this film?
When she's sober. This film more than I've ever loved acting with her in anything. We had the best time. It's not easy to take off your director's hat and put on your actor's hat because you're giving up all this control and things can go south in a nanosecond on an indie shoot. But luckily, Rachel was there, and Rachel is a filmmaker too, so I felt comfortable and I felt confident. And we got to rehearse those scenes. Felicity flew herself down to Atlanta to rehearse them, and it made all the difference in the world.
So talk a little bit about the dynamic in both your households, because you have spouses that are successful in the industry, as well as children that are going into the industry and are finding success. So what's that dynamic like?
Well, for us, we did the best we could to keep our daughters away from it for as long as we could. So they didn't watch TV, and they were confused why people would stop us on the street and want to take a picture with us, but they didn't seem to ask about it. And then my daughter Sophia was doing a handstand and broke her collarbone, and we had to stick her on the couch, and we started playing movies for her, and that was her introduction to the movies, really. And my daughters are pretty normal.
Well, and Sophia's now.
And my daughter's in the tribe. She's going to LOXA, which is the arts high school in Los Angeles, and she's a good actor. I think that's what she's going to do.
And, you know, I actually met my husband because I produced a movie that he wrote, so that's pretty Hollywood, I guess. And, I think that our kids are getting our flair for the dramatic, probably. I don't know what they'll do, you know, my daughter seems interested, and which is sort of terrifying, and but she seems to enjoy slipping into another persona, which I guess is an extension of just your imagination, but she's a little lazy, doesn't want to use her imagination, so someone just tells her, oh, just act like this, and she seems to like it. So, but it's, you know, whatever they want to do. I think the one thing we do drill into our kids is how happy we are, how blessed we feel to be doing this for a living, because we do feel like we were born to be storytellers, the two of us. And so we just try to encourage them to, whatever you're gonna do, work your ass off, work harder than anybody else, and hopefully you love it. And you know, Terry always says, if you love what you do, you'll never work a day in your life. And I think we both feel like that.
So you've talked about how great your kids are, and Rachel's shared how great your kids are, and they have two very busy working parents. What do you do to engage them and bring them up the way they have in such a great way?
Same thing everybody else does, rules. My wife's a great mom, and she studied parenting. I mean, she read all the books, and so rules about the cell phones and social media, and they have chores. And I was home a lot because of our schedule. I'm around the house a lot more than my daughters wish I was.
So you're 6 months on, 6 months off, typically on your shooting schedules?
Right, on Shameless it takes about 6 months, but we shoot in at Warner Brothers, so I'm close to home. I take them to school. That's the new thing, L.A., you know, we have to drive so much, but boy, you hear everything when your kids are in the car. They forget you're there somehow, and they just start talking.
So you mentioned cell phones, and we had a conversation about technology. Talk a little bit about technology and your kids and the impact, and for yourself, the use of technology and your cell phone.
So the flight between LA and New York is now possible because of iPads. Because before that was not so fun with the kids. My kids are still young. I think they don't have phones yet, and my plan is that when they get them, they just won't have any social media until they're much older. More research comes out, the more, no good can come of that for really, really young kids. And I'm also it's probably like sacrilege to say it in this part of California, but I'm not like big into technology. I'm not that good at it, but I know it is sort of the, how critical it is to storytelling, and it is sort of it's an equivalent to creativity in a weird mirror way, because I can't do what I do without way smarter people doing what they do to push everything forward into the future. So I'm just grateful, but it's not my strong suit.
I think you can't put a genie back in a bottle. It's not gonna go away, but we need a Miss Manners to come along and talk about cell phones. I'm getting to the age now where I can say really rude things and get away with it, because he's gray and only knows gris, I think the French say. But I speak up when people take a call at a table and they think they gotta yell. I say, hey, leave the table, what's the matter with you? But I'll tell you, making a film, the technology, I'm old enough that the first film I did, I cut film. They taught me how to cut the film. And there are these garbage cans, expensive garbage cans, filled with pieces of film all over the place. And you can actually lose a scene. It's happened a lot, you lose it. The technology now is magnificent. Once we went digital, it just changed everything. And that's why you can see a movie that's made for under 100 grand, and it's up there competing with a film that cost $100 million. Because the technology is just magnificent. I don't want to go back on that. I like that.
So technology in this film, and one of my favorite characters, talk about how you directed that character of Satan.
We worked a lot together on that. It was not clear in Will's first script. It was not consistent, and Rachel and I sort of decided what it meant. I mean, our take on it is that Satan is fear. It's our fear, our personal fear, and everybody has their personal Satan. And one of my favorite moments in this film is the fact that this white college boy shares that has a Satan that nobody can see but him, except for one other character, and that's a black pimp from Atlanta, and they share a Satan. And I found that profound and moving. What a great way to tell the story on Will's part.
And that aspect of the film ended up becoming very timely. You know, we're in a place and time where fear is a really bad thing, and not standing up is a really bad thing. And this idea that when you come from a place of fear, you're not your best self, and you're not necessarily affecting the kind of change for yourself or for the world around you. And so that aspect of fear, and the aspect of addiction, it ended up becoming, for a film that we just fell in love with so long ago, again, it's a little bit of a cosmic timing thing, that it really has something to say that I think it is poignant for today in a couple of different ways.
I gotta say, when we started making this thing, I think we both had the same moment when we were deep into the prep of how unwieldy it is. It's got so many different elements going at one time. It's downright farce at times. It's got melodrama. It's all over the place, and so many characters to follow. And Satan was tough to figure out how to shoot him and how to do that character. And after 10 or 12 years of trying to get the film made, then Great Point came along and said, okay, go make the movie. And both of us went, Christ, this thing's complicated. How do we do this? And it was a learning process all the way through. We were still talking about what things mean and how they interact with each other when, even after we'd started shooting.
Yeah, absolutely. And the in terms of the technology with Satan, which was a combination of green screen and CG, we were limited by our budget, and it ended up being the best thing for that character, the sort of off-the-shelf nature of the way Satan came to life. Really, really works in the movie. And I shudder to think, like, if we had had all the money in the world, how fucked up we would have been, like, chasing, I think, a lot of different ideas and presentations of him. And had we spent a lot of money on technology for that character, I think we would have maybe lost a little bit of a balance. He fits into the ensemble really nicely now.
It's really one of the nicest things about independent films, that inevitably the filmmakers can't afford what they wanted to do, and they have to come up with other solutions which cost less. And my experience is they are inevitably more elegant than the original. There's something great about, I guess it's the essence of all art, take away everything you can. If you can cut it, then you have to cut it. And that simplification of the process and how to tell the story, I think that's why independent films are sometimes so much better than the big films.